We're very, very fortunate to have our keynote speaker for lunch. Mohamed Khalil was kind enough to reconfigure his schedule to make sure that he can be here. You're going to find, after you quiet down, that his talk will be very, very provocative. Mohamed has over 15 years of experience in the financial services strategy, innovation, and entrepreneurship. And you'll see that he's on the cutting edge of technology and its application in the financial sector. You can read his bio, which is in the program at length. But rather than take time away from him and read the bio, I'm just going to ask him to come to the podium and talk with us. At the end of his talk, feel free to ask questions and so on. And then we're going to try to get back on track in terms of our programming at 1 o'clock. So without further ado, Mohamed Khalil.
Morning, or afternoon, actually. So it's a small group, and I'm going to try to keep my comments as limited as possible, because I'd like to actually have a discussion. I'll tell you a little bit about my background, but I really won't go into Moven, which is the startup that I'm at right now, in too much detail, because I want to give you some thoughts to help you lead you towards why I'm working at Moven. So as Professor Moy was saying, my background is in financial services. I started as a management consultant working with big banks around the world, helping them understand how they can improve their experiences for their clients. And I ended up actually going to work for two big banks, Merrill Lynch and Citigroup, working within their organizations to try to create these new kinds of experiences. Ultimately realized that there's a lot of inertia and challenges within an organization, and decided to go into startup world, where I started to work on those concepts and ideas. And fintech right now is booming in terms of an industry. Within the last few years, everything from Square, PayPal, even the Starbucks coffee card have all fundamentally changed the way we think about money, and most recently, Apple Pay Pass. And so we'll talk about, or I'll talk briefly about how those things have an impact. But to sort of set the context, I think the way that I look at the world today is that we're in the beginnings of what some call the second machine age. And the second machine age is the impact of digitization of products, services, and experiences. And it is not without precedent. We've gone through an industrial revolution where steam engines and electrification fundamentally change the way that we produce products, services, and experiences. And initially, those changes were rather limited, right? So when steam engines came out and when electricity came out, it was rather expensive. And the first users of those products and services were large companies. Factories were able to take out the steam engine from the center of their floors and put in new electrical engines that could provide service in a much more low-cost and efficient way. But that rapidly changed. And if you look at what happened through the 30s and 50s, in sort of the second half of the Industrial Revolution, those changes began to trickle down to real people. And so things that we today take for granted, the labor-saving technologies that we have, whether it's refrigeration, telephones, laundry machines, those altered how we do things. And the clearest example of that impact is that we don't rely on horses anymore to do work, right? We have tractors. And so there's this open question around the second machine age. If we have computing technology, the digitization of these experiences, will human intelligence and involvement be the equivalent of the horse, right? So we replaced labor with this ability to generate stored labor, and now we can replace intellectual capacity with computing technology. What role do we as individuals have in that transition, and how do we ensure that it's used for good purposes? And the challenge is that this change is going to accelerate in a way that I don't think any of us have ever experienced before. So there's this parable of the inventor of chess in India. When he first invented it, the king asked him, you know, this is a great invention. What would you like as your reward? And he said, well, I'd like you to put one grain of rice on the first chessboard, chess space, and keep doubling it. And I want that to be my total. Now, if you looked at the first half of the chessboard, by the time he got to the 32nd cell, you had 100 tons of grain, right? And so that's where we're at today, right? We were at the first half of the chessboard where improvements and the exponential growth in our ability to do things has been manageable. We can adapt, right? It took us 5 years to get smartphone technology in our hands, and now it fundamentally changes the way we behave and do things. But we're now entering the second half of the chessboard. And by the time you get to the 64th cell on that chessboard, you have 461 billion tons of rice, right? The pace of change becomes so fast that adapting is extremely difficult. I mean, that's more rice than we would ever produce in 1,000 years. So how do you prepare for that kind of world where the technology, right, the capabilities are advancing so rapidly, where Moore's law means that the cost of storing information, the cost of processing information doubles in capability and halves in price every 9 to 18 months. And you see that today with the fact that voice recognition technology 10 years ago, it was not something that you could use. And today, a lot of voice recognition technology is built into everything from Siri to when you call your bank to ask about your balance. Driverless cars were a pipe dream 3 to 5 years ago. Today, Google and others are within a few years of being able to deploy driverless cars on the road. Low-cost space exploration, that's another advance of our ability to compute and analyze information in new ways and come up with better solutions. So these are the beginnings of what can be fundamental shifts in our experiences. And so the output of all that is that we have bounty. We have huge amounts of bounty. If you think about the bounty that was generated by the second half of the Industrial Revolution, the things that we take for granted today, you know, try to live without your refrigerator or washing machine or telephone for a few weeks and see how difficult that is. Today, try to live without your Google Maps or your Facebook or, you know, your ability to get an Uber ride. And it becomes also, you recognize that there's this huge amount of bounty that's been generated. But Picasso said once that computers are useless, right? They can only give you answers. And that is where I think we can have the impact. It's, are we asking the right questions? Mark Andreessen once said that, you know, if you look at the advent of technology to date, you know, they promised us in the 50s flying cars and, you know, colonies on Mars. Where are those? And I think we're on our way towards that. And so how do we ask the right questions? Well, when it comes to finance, and I'm going to bring it back to sort of the world I'm in, but the questions that I'm going to raise may apply to whatever you may be doing. When it comes to finance, everybody seems focused on removing friction around spending. So with PayPal, with Apple Pay, you're going to be able to walk into a store, put the phone on the register, and put your thumbprint and pay and walk out. With the current Starbucks card, you can actually walk in, show your face, pick up your coffee, and walk out. Everyone is working towards this technology where you literally want you to be able to walk into a store, pick up whatever you want off the shelf, and walk out with no checkout, with no register, right? And it's all about spending. It's all about making it easier for people to consume. At Moven, we looked at that and we said, well, really, is that the problem? You know, FDR said something that the test of our progress is not whether we add more to the abundance of those who have much, it is whether we provide enough for those who have too little, right? And so today, it seems that the solutions we are coming up with are those for those who have enough already, and not necessarily for those who don't have enough. And so there are three things that we think about at Moven in developing our product. We look at not just bounty, but spread. We look at not just what, but why. And we look at how digitization impacts our business model. And so when I talk about bounty versus spread, what I mean by that is that all this value that we're bringing, how is it going to be allocated across customers? You know, is Apple Pay going to provide services that allow banks and merchants to be more profitable at the expense of consumers? Or is it going to be more like Uber or Lyft, where there is some value, or Airbnb, where there's some value being generated back to the initial user, where I, as a consumer with a car that I don't use all the time, can create value for myself there? And so we also think about why versus what. One way I talk about that, what I mean is that it's not about the technology. While our product is focused on mobile and about bringing banking into this mobile world and the digitization of money, we recognize that because we're about to enter the second half of the chessboard, if we focus on the what, the technology, we're never going to be able to keep up. And so we have to think about why we are doing what we're doing. What is the problem we're trying to solve, not what is the technology we're trying to deploy? And the problem that we believe we're trying to solve is one of financial wellness, of financial health, of helping people improve their financial health. This is the difference between being Barnes & Noble and deciding that you sell books and being Amazon or iTunes and realizing that you sell content, right? You don't care about the technology, you care about the why you're doing this. I'm providing people with access to this particular content, this particular intelligence, this particular experience. And then rethinking your model. When those factories switched from steam engines to electrical engines, what they found was that because steam engines were big and hefty and bulky, that their floor plans were actually very compact and very vertical. They would put the steam engine in the center, build whatever tools they needed around it, and then would stack them on top of each other because it was all about how far you were from the steam. But we know we don't have that same problem with electricity, but it took them 30 years to understand that the way that they approached solving the problem was fundamentally flawed, that you can actually build smaller generators, motors that you can build into machines, and you can just wire them and connect them. And so the factory floor plan that we see today is the result of that. Whereas if you went back to the 30s and 40s, it still had this inability to adjust to this new paradigm. And so for Moven, what that meant was that we are building a financial health solution. And we took the Hippocratic Oath for medical services and said, this applies to financial health. This idea of do no harm, right? We want to build our business model where when the consumer benefits, we benefit. When the consumer fails, we fail. And then think about that in terms of your current banking experience today. When you fail, the banks benefit. When you overdraft, they get the fee. When you carry balances on a high rate interest card, they make the benefit. And that's because it's the old model. It's a model of branch-based selling. It's the model of high cost marketing because effectively I'm selling a commoditized service, right? I challenge anyone to tell me the difference between a Bank of America checking account and a Chase checking account, right? There is no differentiation there. But when you think about digital and the impact that digital can have, it's about the experience. And so if we can provide you with an experience that allows you to live your life better, to spend a little bit smarter, to save a little bit more, then we can build a business model aligned around your benefit, aligning with our benefit. We also believe in prevention before cure, right? So we look at why are we doing these things rather than what. We want to prevent you having a situation where you cannot handle an unexpected event, the doctor's bill, the dentist's bill, the car repair, right? Those are all things that 50% of consumers today could not find $2,000 within 30 days to address those types of things. And so if we can use the power of data and digitization to analyze how others have spent and how others have behaved and give you feedback on the fact that if you continue to behave this way, you are going to set yourself up for failure and you are going to get sick. And we would rather not have you sick and make money off of the interest that we're going to charge you, but we'd rather have you well and find a way to benefit from you having savings and the ability to fulfill your dreams. And the final piece is care for the community. This idea that we believe that confidence is contagious, that if we can provide people with the right tools, the right services, that the impact it will have on their lives is beyond the financial. It's the emotional, it's the physical, it's removing the anxiety, allowing you to give more to your family, to your friends, and to your community. It also means for us fundamentally as an organization that just like Tesla came out a few months ago and said, all our patents are yours, what they realize is that this is a far too big problem for any one company to solve, and that this is a place where people can cooperate and work together to find solutions. And so we have that same mentality. We are willing to share our insights, we are willing to share our experiences, our successes and our failures with others, because we think that this problem of financial health in the United States is something that all can participate and help. So that's the Moven story, and that's how it fits into this concept of the second machine age, the second half of the chessboard, the difference between bounty and spread, and the question of why versus what. Thank you. Any questions?